is good to see everybody here this morning. Thank God for this good rain that we're getting. Let's sing together. Have faith in God. All right. Have faith in God when your pathway is lonely. He sees and knows all the way you have trod. Never alone are the least of his children. Have faith in God. Have faith in God. Have faith in God. He's on his throne. Have faith in God. He watches o'er his own. He cannot fail. He must prevail. Have faith in God. Have faith in God. Have faith in God in your pain and your sorrow. His heart is touched with your grief and despair. Cast all your cares and your burdens upon him and leave them there. Oh, leave them there. Have faith in God. He's on his throne. Have faith in God. He watches o'er his own. He cannot fail. He must prevail. Have faith in God. Have faith in God. Have faith in God, though all else fail about you. Have faith in God. He provides for his own. He cannot fail, though all kingdoms shall perish. He rules, he reigns upon his throne. Have faith in God, he's on his throne. Have faith in God, he watches o'er his own. He cannot fail, he must prevail. Have faith in God, have faith in God. Why should I be discouraged? Why should the shadows come? Why should my heart be lonely and long for heaven and home? When Jesus is my portion, my constant friend is he. His eye is on the sparrow, and I know he watches me. His eye is on a sparrow, and I know he watches me. I sing because I'm happy. I sing because I'm free. For his eye is on the sparrow, and I know he watches me. Let not your heart be troubled. His tender words I hear, and resting on his goodness, I lose my doubt and fear. Though by the path he leadeth, but one step I may see. His eye is on the sparrow, and I know he watches me. His eye is on the sparrow, and I know he watches me. I sing because I'm happy. I sing because I'm free. For his eye is on the sparrow, and I know he watches me. Aren't you glad that you're held safely in the Lord's hand?
Hoo-ah.
And that nothing will snatch you out of his hand? He cares for us more than the sparrows, and the hairs of our head are numbered. He knows everything that we're going through. Praise God, he is always with us. Praise him for his care in our lives. And we're going to raise a hallelujah about that. I raise a hallelujah in the presence of my enemies. I raise a hallelujah louder than the unbelief. I raise a hallelujah. My weapon is a melody. I raise a hallelujah. Heaven comes to fight for me. I'm gonna sing in the middle of the storm. Louder and louder, you're gonna hear my praises roar. Up from the ashes, hope will arise. Death is defeated, the King is alive. I raise a hallelujah with everything inside of me. I raise a hallelujah. I will watch the darkness flee. I raise a hallelujah in the middle of the mystery. I raise a hallelujah. Fear, you lost your hold on me. I'm gonna sing in the middle of the storm. Louder and louder, you're gonna hear my praises roar. Up from the ashes, hope will arise. Death is defeated, the King is alive.
In the presence of my enemies,
sing a little louder.
Louder than the unbelief,
sing a little louder.
My weapon is a melody,
sing a little louder.
Heaven comes to fight for me,
sing a little louder.
In the presence of my enemies,
sing a little louder.
Louder than the unbelief,
sing a little louder.
My weapon is a melody,
sing a little louder.
Heaven comes to fight for me,
sing a little louder.
I'm gonna sing in the middle of the storm. Louder and louder, you're gonna hear my praises roar. Up from ashes, hope will arise. Death is defeated, the King is alive.
Hallelujah, the King is alive. Yes, hallelujah. This next song, Praise Adonai. Adonai is just the Hebrew word for Lord or Master. That's what that means there. Thank you. like him, the lion and the lamb, seated on the throne. Mountains bow down, and every ocean roars to the Lord of hosts. Praise Adonai, from the rising of the sun to the end of every day. Praise Adonai, all the nations of the earth, all the angels and the saints sing praise. Who is like him? The lion comes shall bow, and every tongue confess. Holy Son of God, giver of all life, and conqueror of death. Praise Adonai, from the rising of the sun to the end of every day. Praise Adonai, all the nations of the earth, all the angels and the saints sing praise. Nations of the earth, all the angels and the saints sing praise Adonai, from the rising of the sun till the end of every day. Praise Adonai, all the nations of the earth, all the angels and the saints sing praise. Sing praise. Praise.
Amen.
Everything for good, God, whatever
way, I will trust you. God, whatever comes my way, I will trust you. All my hopes, all I need, held in your hands. All my life, all of me, held in your hands. All my fears, all my dreams, held in your hands. All my hopes, all I need, held in your hands. All my life, all of me, held in your hands. All my fears, all my dreams, held in your hands. In your everlasting arms, all the pieces of my life, from beginning to the end, I can trust you. In your never failing love, work everything for good. God, whatever comes my way, I will trust you. God, whatever comes my way, I will trust you. God, whatever comes my way, I will trust you.
Thank you. Thank you, choir. If you would, go ahead and turn in your Bibles to 1 Kings chapter 17. And I found it fitting as I woke up at 3 o'clock this morning because with a house with a metal roof, I can't hear the rain at all. And I woke to the rain coming down after we've had quite the dry spell. And I thought to myself as I try to go back to sleep, I thought that was very fitting because today we are going to be talking about Elijah. And as some of you guys might know, the story of Elijah, the main one you might know is his confrontation with the prophets of Baal and him praying for there to be no rain for 3.5 years. And this is really just a small glimpse of Elijah. And so today, we are taking 3 chapters of Elijah and going to squish it down into about 30 minutes. It is funny. And my point in doing this is that you would fall in love with this character so that you will go and read it yourselves. Because Elijah, he is one of the two from the Old Testament who meets Jesus on the Mount of Transfiguration. He is the prophet of all the prophets. So you have Moses meet Jesus and you have Elijah. And John the Baptist comes in the spirit of Elijah. And as in Malachi, it prophesies. And so Elijah is the prophet. He doesn't have his own book, but in Kings, 1 and 2 Kings, we see Elijah. And man, we need to know more about this because in James, it talks about how whenever you want to look for someone who is a prayer warrior, someone who fervently prays for something, you look to Elijah. So now we're going to look to Elijah and we're going to get to know him and his story. And so the nation of Israel has spiraled. They have gone from bad king to bad king to bad king to, not that bad. There's a bad king now. And now we have a really bad king in Omri and then Ahab, which is even worse. And Ahab is married to a queen, Jezebel, who is not from the nation of Israel, but is from another nation. And she brings in her own idols and her own pagan gods. And idolatry and sin is rampant in the land. And now we see Elijah, the movie star of prophets, burst onto the scene. And he's not a fortune teller. He's not telling and predicting future like we might think, but he is the mouthpiece of God who is going to tell the people how it is and how it's going to be. And so in 1 Kings 17, verse 1, now Elijah the Tishbite of Tishbe in Gilead said to Ahab, "As the Lord, the God of Israel, lives, before whom I stand, there shall neither be dew nor rain these years except by my word." The idol most commonly chased after and worshipped by the people, this false god Baal, is the god of rain and fertility and growth. And so God is showing them, this God that you have been running to, chasing after instead of me, I'm going to turn off that tap. I'm going to turn off what you pray to him to give you. Because just like in Hosea 2, whenever we have the picture of the wife that is wayward, who runs after these other gods, these other men, it's God that's providing. And yet they run and pray to another god. And so God has to be firm with them. Fine. No water. Turn off the tap. And so God allows hardship for a reason. And that's your first point in your outline as you're following along. God allows hardship for a reason. It is not just to punish the nation of Israel for no good reason. And Elijah is brought in on board with this because he is about to bring revival. And that is what Elijah, his goal is to bring revival, bring people back to God, and God is willing to do whatever is necessary, even ceasing the rain for 3.5 years. And so, we often put our faith in interesting things, and people have put their faith in something that brings rain, supposedly, even though it's going to rain most likely anyways. God is bringing the rain, but they've put their faith in something else. And so, God is laying the gauntlet down, and we are going to see what happens between him and Baal. And so as the rain gets shut off and food becomes scarce in the land, he takes Elijah and takes him to a brook, and he says that, "I will feed you with ravens, and you will drink from the brook. I don't know about you, but if I had my chickens come up to me and drop a piece of meat at my feet, I would be skeptical. Is it raw? Did you cook it? Did you steal it from somebody? I don't know that I want this." But Elijah is being provided for by these ravens, by God. And so, and it's funny, as we sing, "His eye is on the sparrow," and Luke is talking about ravens. Consider the ravens. God looks after them. Surely he will look after you. And here, the ravens are the one that's looking after Elijah. Kind of a neat turn on that. And so we cannot discount he's getting fed by a raven, but where are the people in the nation getting fed right now? There is desperation in the land. And even so much so that the brook dries up and Elijah is called, "I need you to go to Zarephath." And so let's read in 17:9-12. "Arise, go to Zarephath, which belongs to Sidon, and dwell there. Behold, I have commanded a widow there to feed you." So he arose and went to Zarephath. And when he came to the gate of the city, behold, a widow was there gathering sticks. And he called to the widow and said to her, "Bring me a little water in the vessel that I may drink. Not a small thing in a drought." And as she was going to bring it, he called to her and said, "Bring me a morsel of bread in your hand." And she said, "As the Lord lives, I have nothing baked, only a handful of flour in a jar and a little oil in a jug. And now I am gathering a couple of sticks that I might go in and prepare it for myself and my son, that we may eat it and die." This woman, who Elijah has been promised he is going to be taken care of by a widow, this woman is supposed to be taking care of him, and she is on her last leg. She has given up hope. She has completely said, "This is our last food. We're about to die. I have nothing left." Which must mean that everybody else has very little left, that there's nothing else to go around to the widows. And yet Elijah has been promised. And so he shares that promise. And Elijah said to her, "Do not fear. Go and do as you have said. But first make me a little cake and bring it to me. And afterwards make something for yourself. For thus says the Lord, the God of Israel, the jar of flour shall not be spent and the jug of oil shall not be empty until the day that the Lord sends rain upon the earth." So God has prepared to supply Elijah, prepare his table, set his table. And where is he at? The queen Jezebel is from this nation and not too far off. God has brought him out of the nation of Israel and has brought him into the very place where people are seeking Elijah's life, where the heart of this idolatry started. Whenever Jezebel came in and whispered secrets and lies into the king's ear to get him to worship other gods, this is where she is from. He is on her territory. And yet God brings him here to care for this widow and this son. And as Psalm 23 says, he is preparing a meal in the presence of his enemies. He is literally being provided for years in the presence of his enemies. And so can you imagine the blessing every morning where this woman is, she's taking a step of faith. She calls out his God, "As the Lord your God lives." She must have known who he was or known that he was not of this nation. But then how amazing that she gave up that last bit of bread. Like, I guess this last meal might as well be a little smaller. But then the next morning she wakes up and only to be provided for and that promise to be given. But this happiness doesn't continue. Because even though God's promise and His presence is here, that does not mean that there is no suffering. But likewise, the presence of suffering does not mean that God has left and His promises are not still being fulfilled, because now the widow's son falls ill. He's sick. So sick that it says that his breath had left him. He is dead. And she cries out and she said, "Why? Are these my old sins coming back up against me? Whenever I served other gods, whenever I did those other things that in my past," and he said, "Give your son to me." So he took him up in the upper room and he prays. And despite our circumstances, despite what may be going on in our life, God remains God. And so he was God whenever he was providing the oil and the flour day after day, and he is still God whenever her son is dead. Oftentimes we have this view of God where good things happening, good God. Bad things happening to me, bad God. He is God. He is the same. And to show that he is a God not just of sustaining and giving bread, he is a God of life. And he brings, as Elijah prays, God resurrects this young boy. What a beautiful story, because Elijah is now excited. His goal, remember, is he is bringing revival to the land. He is wanting to bring the hearts and minds of these people back to God. And now, this woman, this foreign woman, her son, not only has she been provided for, her son has been brought back to life. And he must think to himself, now is the time where the spiritual life of the nation is going to be brought back up, is going to be resurrected, and they're going to follow God. And so God calls him and says, "Go show yourself to Ahab." This is chapter 18 now. And so he says, "Go and show yourself to Ahab, and I will send rain upon the earth." Okay, now Elijah sees the revival is about to happen. He's excited. He is going to go face to face with Ahab, but on the way he meets Obadiah. And Obadiah was a prophet. He was a little bit on the quieter side. He was willing to, he still wanted to serve God. He, while God was taking care of Elijah in the desert, Obadiah was taking care of God's prophets and hiding them from Ahab and from Jezebel, trying to keep them safe. And so he's not a bad guy, but he is a little on the scared side, because he sees Elijah. He bows down. He's like, "Oh, thank God, finally you're here. Ahab's been seeking to kill you all over the place, but you are here. Surely you have a plan. What's the plan?" And Elijah says to him, "Take me to Ahab." And Obadiah's like, "No, that's not what we're doing. You've been on the run. If I take you to Ahab, you're going to die. And he's going to kill me if I say, hey, Elijah's over here, and then you're not there, then I'm going to die." But Elijah says, "It's time. The showdown, it's time." And so we get Ahab and Elijah meeting in 18, verse 17. Chapter 18, verse 17. Let's read it. "When Ahab saw Elijah, Ahab said to him, 'Is it you, you troubler of Israel?' And he answered, 'I have not troubled Israel, but you have, and your father's house, because you have abandoned the commandments of the Lord and followed the Baals. Now, therefore, send and gather all Israel to me at Mount Carmel, and the 450 prophets of Baal and the 400 prophets of Asherah, who eat at Jezebel's table.'" Now, Ahab, as we often do, sometimes whenever we've made mistakes and we've put ourselves in situations that is not God's plan, and we have done things that have pushed us away from God, we blame the Holy One. We blame the one when it was really us all along. And as you see here, Ahab has not done a very good job of purging. He has not followed God. He has allowed the people, the prophets of these false idols, to sit at his table and at the table of his wife. He is okay with the evil and the sin and the idolatry to hang around. and in our lives as well, if we do not watch who we surround ourselves with, what we put into our brain, who we listen to on TV or on our phones, what do we start looking like? We start shaping and molding ourselves into our environment. And when we allow things to speak into us that is not of God, you're going to follow things that are not of God. Do not be surprised. And so in verse 20, so Ahab sent all the people of Israel and gathered the prophets together at Mount Carmel. Mount Carmel is the place where Baal's presence is felt the most. And Elijah came near to the people and said, how long will you go limping between two different opinions? If the Lord is God, follow him. But if Baal, then follow him. And the people did not answer him with a word. Then Elijah said to the people, I only am left of the prophet of the Lord. But the Baal's prophets are 450 men. Let two bulls be given to us. Let them choose one bull for themselves and cut it to pieces and lay it on the wood and put no fire to it. And I will prepare another bull and lay it on the wood and put no fire to it. And you call upon the name of your God, and I will call upon the name of the Lord. And the God who answers by fire, he is God. And the people answered, it is well spoken. Then Elijah said to the prophets of Baal, choose for yourself one bull and prepare it first, for you are many, and call upon the name of your God, but put no fire to it. And then they took the bull that was given them and prepared it and called upon the name of Baal from morning until noon, saying, O Baal, answer us. But there was no voice. No one answered. And they limped around the altar that they had made. And at noon, Elijah mocked them, saying, cry aloud, for he is God. Either he is musing, or he is relieving himself, or he is on a journey, or perhaps he is asleep and must be awakened. And they cried aloud and cut themselves after their custom with swords and lances until blood gushed out upon them. And a midday passed, they raved on until the time of the offering of oblation. And there was no voice. No one answered. No one paid attention. And so, we have our next point. All your false gods will leave you alone and without answers. All the gods and idols that we bring into our lives will leave you alone and without answers. This is the climax of the story. Elijah has been prepared for this. He is ready for the revival to happen. So he calls all of Israel to come and to be witness to God and what he is about to do. But then he claims to the people, he calls out and he said, if the Lord is God, follow him. But if Baal, follow him. But they said nothing. And this reminds me oftentimes whenever I get into an argument with my wife. If Morgan calls me out on something that I've done wrong, let's say this. I know it's rare, but Morgan calls me out on something that I've done wrong. I have a few options. I can get angry with her. I can get mad at her and get defensive. But all the time I know, I was the one that did it wrong. I could put something back in her face. Hey, what about you? Look at what you did. But that's not going to solve anything. That doesn't change the fact of what I did. So sometimes I remain silent because I don't want to change my action. And maybe if I remain quiet, maybe this will blow over and I can continue the life that I was living. The people remain silent. If the Lord is God, follow him. If Baal is God, follow him. Stop your fence sitting. Stop limping in between these two options. God does not love a fence sitter. Yet how often in our lives do we give maybe Sunday morning, that's God's day. Maybe Wednesday night. But then the rest of the week, we serve our own gods. We serve ourselves. We worship the other things. And we'd rather not God be in part of those. God does not love a fence sitter. And so now we see that Elijah is stacking the odds against God, because there are 450 prophets. Now, the prophets of Asherah did not come. That's an important point to note. But the prophets of Baal are 450. And he's come to their mountain. This is the mountain that Baal is worshipped at. Which, by the way, if Baal being a god of thunder and rain and lightning, if I was to go up on a mountaintop where it usually thunders and lightnings, that would probably make me feel like, oh, this is where God is. But you know what they say? In Colorado, you better be off that mountain by noon and coming down, because if you're not, like I was one time, a lightning strike will strike across the sky whenever you're up at the top. My hair literally stood up on my arms. I felt the electricity. It was no good. But if I wanted to say, hey, that's where God lives, because that's where electricity always happens, that's where lightning always happens, then so be it. But this is, they're on his turf. Elijah is on their turf of, this is the mountain where Baal exists. Then lightning shouldn't be a problem. You should be able to get fire to rain down. It shouldn't be too hard for the lightning god to do something. And yet, even though they get the first pick of the bull, they get the pick of the spot, God specializes at being at a disadvantage. God is not scared of being put in impossible situations, or what we would say is impossible situations, and it continues to get even more impossible, as we're about to see with Elijah. But first, before he lets them just go, silence isn't good enough, he mocks them. Oh, is he in the toilet? Is he going to the bathroom? Is he on a trip? Is he asleep? Maybe we can wake him up. Because he knows that that false god is not listening. He is not there. But what's sad is that oftentimes we might do what these prophets do, which is, he's not answering, God's not answering, this idol that I have in my life is not answering, and so I'm going to give up my very lifeblood, the thing that makes me live. And as they're cutting themselves and pouring out blood on the altar, it's a gruesome scene. It is horrifying. And yet, false idols will ask you to give up your very blood, to give up your energy, not just what you own, but your very soul. They will ask you to give it up and nothing given in return. And not only that, it's very interesting, this idea of limping. He says, don't go limping from God to God. If Baal is God, follow him. If the Lord is God, follow him. And then we see they are limping around as their custom. And not only does this false god ask you to give up your very soul, your lifeblood, the energy that you have, he is going to leave you limping and lame. When we follow idols, when we follow things that we want, like, let's put it in perspective. We don't think of idols all the time. We think of idols as maybe a third world country. No. Idolatry is very real and very prevalent in the American church. Don't be lied to about this. We all have idols. Is it money? Is your idol money? Maybe if I had enough money, if I worked hard enough, this would finally be enough. But then you have to continue to give and give. Give up your time with your family. Give up your time with God to do whatever it takes to get that money. It asks for your very life. Is it food? Uh-oh. Is it food? Is it maybe I can drown my sorrows, drown my sadness, drown this if I just eat whatever I want? And then is it yourself? Is it your comfort? Please, anything, I'll give up anything as long as you don't take my comfort. But what happens is we limp through life whenever God, who is the God of resurrection and life, is sitting there saying, follow me. Like Forrest Gump, we don't want to be put into the leg braces, but we want to run. And as in the movie, it's whenever he runs, that's when the braces fall off. And so as we look to God, we need to run to him, because God is a God of life, and our idols only bring death. And now it's Elijah's turn. So in verse 30, and Elijah said to the people, "Come near to me." And all the people came near to him, and he repaired the altar of the Lord that had been thrown down. Elijah took 12 stones according to the number of the tribes of Jacob, to whom the word of the Lord came, saying, "Israel shall be your name." And with these stones he built an altar to the name of the Lord. And he made a trench about the altar as great as would contain 2 seahs of seed. And he put the wood in order to cut the bull in pieces and laid it on the wood. And he said, "Fill 4 jars with water and pour it on the burnt offering and on the wood." And they did it and he said, "Do it a second time." And they did it a second time. "Do it a third time," he said, and they did it a third time. And the water ran around the altar and filled the trench also. God is the God of the impossible. He is not worried about how impossible we say a thing. And so Elijah is saying, "You couldn't get the fire started with dry wood. Let's try wet wood. And in the middle of the drought, I know that God has promised that this drought is soon to be over. And so this precious water that you guys have been dying for over the last 3.5 years, I'm pouring it out on this altar because I know that my God is going to answer my prayer." And at the time of the offering of oblation, Elijah and the prophet came near and said, "O Lord, God of Abraham, Isaac, and Israel, let it be known that this day that you are God in Israel, and that I am your servant, and that I have done all these things at your word." Now listen to this. 37, "Answer me, O Lord, answer me, that this people may know you, O Lord, our God, and that you have turned their hearts back." And then the fire of the Lord fell and consumed the burnt offering and the wood and the stones and the dust and licked up the water that was in the trench. And when all people saw it, they fell on their faces and said, "The Lord, He is God. The Lord, He is God." He rebuilds the altar first, right? And what he is trying to tell us is that the God that you served before, that performed miracles before, that was the Father, the God of your fathers and your ancestors, He is alive. As the Lord your God lives, we do not serve a dead God. We do not serve a God that is just made of man-made objects. We serve a living God who was and is to come. And so he's setting up this altar. And then he just starts dumping water on it. He is putting himself in a place where faith has to be possible, where God is saying, "There is no other way this could happen except by me. I might be tempted to pour gasoline on it and light a fire to it and say it was water. That would be my temptation. God, you can't handle this. Let me handle this." But he pours water and soaks it. And so we see that God answers immediately. And the reason that we need to focus in on this is because when we ask things in the name of Jesus, we are asking that in the name of the one that saves, Yahweh saves. And now Elijah is asking this not for himself, not for his own ends, but because he wants them to turn back to God. He wants the people desperately to turn back to God. Elijah is fighting this battle where this nation is lost and they have not turned to God. And he doesn't know. He prays to God that it's possible, and God answers. And now, I want you to think about the people in your life that seem impossible, that seem too far gone for God to answer. Is anything too big for your God? No. Is anyone too lost for your God? No. God is the God of resurrection and life. And as he brings fire down, there is nothing left. It consumes rock, water, bull, sand, all of it. It is consumed, and all that's left is God. So powerful and so beautiful. And now we see that the people are now behind Elijah, and he sends after and he says, "We need to kill these prophets." Again, this is Old Testament. Why is this happening? How can we apply this to our lives? The whole reason that idolatry was a continual thorn in Israel's side is because they continued to give small footholds of idolatry. And in the same way, if we give small footholds of sin into our life and we do not completely destroy, completely eradicate, it's going to come back. Evil does not sleep. If we stay stagnant, evil, sin, idolatry creeps in. And so, this side of the cross, we do not kill sinners. We do not kill those people that are far from God, yet we do give our life for them. And just like earlier, if you have those people in your life that you think are too far gone, what are you willing to give up? What are you willing to sacrifice of your own life and your own comfort to reach them by any means necessary? God is the God of life. And then rain comes. Rain comes down onto the land, thank God. Years of drought. And yet, Jezebel, who did not send her prophets, interesting, sometimes whenever we know that our sin is sin, we'd rather not take it to God. We would rather it not be destroyed. And so Jezebel kept her prophets back and now is willing to kill Elijah. Not to mention the rain has come. The prayer has been answered. Obviously, Elijah is the servant of the true God, and yet she is trying to kill him. And so we see that sometimes whenever we have sin in our life, whenever we have... And if you want to know, like speaking of idolatry, we don't really talk about it a whole lot. If you want to know what idols you have in your life, let me start taking things away from your life and the thing that you go like this and try to take back. Found it. Found the soft spot. Because sometimes we're willing to ignore, keep our sin over here, God over here, so it doesn't get, the light doesn't shine on this darkness. Sometimes we're even willing to kill what God would have put done in our lives in order to save that sin. And so Elijah is in a tough spot now. He is desperate. He is alone, and he is honestly just fed up. He thought the revival moment would happen, and it seems to not be that way. It's not going according to his plan. In chapter 19, verse 4, he sat under a broom tree and he asked that he might die, saying, "Is it enough now, God? Take away my life, for I am no better than my fathers. I haven't been able to do what you asked." But an angel takes care of him, and then he goes out on a journey. And he goes to the mountain of God, Mount Horeb, where Moses met with God, where Moses saw, and the people in Exodus saw the power of God in fire, in an earthquake, in shaking and booming of God's voice. And he travels 40 days and 40 nights. He's weak. He doesn't have food. And he finds a cave. And even though Elijah has run, God has not left him. And he doesn't call out from outside of the cave that Elijah is in. He doesn't say, "Hey, what are you doing in there?" God is near him and says, "What are you doing in here? Why are we here? I'm here with you." And so Elijah is saying, "I've been jealous for you, God. But the people of Israel have forsaken you. They've killed your prophets. They've thrown down your altars. And I am only left, and they seek my life." And so he says, "Come out of the cave, go on to the mountain and stand." So God sends a wind, a great wind that passes by and shakes the earth. But God was not in the wind. And then he sends an earthquake that shakes the very mountain that he's on, but God was not in the earthquake. And then he sends fire and passes by, and God is not in the fire. And then a small whisper. It's amazing how many times in our lives that we have seen people that have seen miracles of God and power of God and have turned away. This happens all the time in the Bible. We often think, if God would just do this big miracle, then I would believe. more often than not, it seems like that small, still voice that says, I am here with you. You are not alone. I have a plan for you. It's the most important thing that we can hear. He's dealing with depression. He must be. He's sad. He's alone. And yet God says, I'm not done with you. You are not alone. I have a plan for you. He didn't need to see God in his power. He had seen him resurrect a boy. He had seen fire come down from heaven. He'd seen rain stop. He needed a personal God. And praise God that we're on this side of the cross where we not only get a personal God, but the Holy Spirit that is promised, the helper that helps us in our time of need, that stays close to us. He is a personal God, and he shows himself in his closeness to us. And so his commandment to Elijah to go out and to anoint others, that there are 7,000 more that are going to be with you that have not turned to Baal, that are going to be on your side, this is encouragement. And so the revival didn't happen in his timeline, but now he comes close and promises. And so in summary, I have a few things that I want you to make sure and take home. And I hope that this story, I just blazed over that story. I hope you go and really dig into Elijah. He is one of the most important characters in the Old Testament. You need to know about Elijah. But these last three summarizes these points here. First off, you need to make your choice. It's not a fun thing to ask, not a fun thing to say, but God is the God of the universe who deserves every bit of you. Not half, not a quarter, not some, all. Being a fence sitter, not taking care of the idols that you have in your life, those false things that you chase after you, that you think if I pour enough energy and time into it, it'll make me happy. If you do not get rid of those and you continue to worship them, your relationship is going to continue to limp on with God and your life is going to limp on. 2, pray earnestly to God who seeks to save the lost, who is the God of resurrection and life. Continue to pray earnestly for those people. Do not give up on them. Do not give up on them. God is the God of life, and he wants all to know his name. And he is okay with impossible situations, so do not count anyone out in your life. And lastly, know that the God who came in power on Mount Carmel, brought fire down, that raised that boy from the dead, that provided for the needs of the widow and the son, who came to God, to Elijah in a whisper to be close to him. That same God is the God that you serve today, that you have the availability to worship and to love today. He does not ask you to give up something for nothing. He does ask you to hand your life over, but it's not for nothing. God will give you life. He will give it in abundance. He does not ask you to shed your blood, because he shed his blood on the cross for you. And he wants you to have life. And so, make your decision. Let's pray earnestly for those that are lost. And know this is the same God who was and is to come. Let's pray. Heavenly Father.